Hi, I'm Andrea from AWS. Here are some innovative ways AWS customers are using compute in the cloud. Let's start with Insider, which is ingesting billions of data points daily to power their real-time products.
Once we write the data, we read it back into EKS to our consumers, and we provision more consumers depending on how much data we have in the queue, as I said. And once we read that data, that piece of traffic actually, we write it three ways. We write it to DynamoDB, our OLAP DB solution, which is ClickHouse, and then we write it to an S3 bucket.
Okay. Why the segregation of data between Dynamo and ClickHouse and S3?
Well, we use S3 to troubleshoot our problems.
Okay.
What we do is we write every piece of traffic to S3 along with a lot of metadata. So in case there is like a bad integration or unwanted data situations, we just plug Athena in to S3 to find the root cause of that unwanted data. We can easily identify it via the metadata that we write alongside the traffic.
Okay.
So like we can do quick troubleshooting regarding the ingestion of data.
Okay.
And another use case we have is if something goes wrong with our data sources, we can just replay the entire traffic between a specified amount of time from Athena, and we just read the traffic back and write it to queue, and then the process starts all over again.
That's great. It's a really powerful use case with Athena as well.
AirBNB is focused on tenants, but in this compute case, we're looking at how they are securing multi-tenant Kubernetes clusters at scale.
So what are some of the business challenges that you are trying to solve with your architecture?
Yeah, so at Airbnb, we run our own multi-tenant Kubernetes clusters on EC2. We want our own clusters because we sometimes need to backport fixes or add new features into our Kubernetes. And the main challenge that we ran into in the past was we have many different pods that run on a single host. And we want to give fine-grain access controls or fine-grain IAM roles to these pods. And so the way we do that now is, we have our control plane that manages all of our pods in our cluster. What the control plane does is it injects service account tokens into the pod.
And that control plane is one of the EC2s?
Yes, that's correct. The control plane runs on a physically separate EC2 host than all of our worker nodes.
Okay.
So the control plane injects tokens. These tokens are cryptographically signed, but they contain basically an identity. They act like an ID card for these pods. And some things that a token will have are what namespace the pod belongs to, and also the name of the pod. The pod can then take this token and send it directly to STS.
Okay.
For verification. Since I mentioned before, these pods are cryptographically signed. STS can verify that the token is valid and hasn't been tampered with. If that all checks out, STS can then check the IAM role and verify that the namespace and the name of the pod is able to assume the IAM role that it's requesting. And if all that checks out, STS will get temporary credentials for that IAM role and send those credentials back to the pods.
So from a multi-tenant perspective, how do you secure those pods in a more clustered manner in your Kubernetes cluster?
Yeah, it's a good question. So each pod has its own identity that's provided by our control plane. And in the IAM role definition itself, service owners are able to say like, IAM role foo, for example, should only be allowed to be assumed by pods in the foo namespace. So given that connection with each other, we can guarantee that other pods in different namespaces cannot assume foo's IAM role.
Our last segment will show how 3M is building an HPC modeling platform to simplify AWS usage for scientists and engineers.
Say this user is requesting a material. They want to see the properties of a given material within the system. The very first thing that happens after that request comes through is that we actually go over and we hit our DynamoDB here that's dedicated to determining whether or not they have that access. So within this table, we have UUIDs of each material within the system. We have user IDs associated with that material, and then their access level, so a bit mask that tells us what they're allowed to accomplish with that material.
So really fine-grained access control there. You mentioned UUIDs. Why?
Yeah, so access control is really important for us. 3M thrives on our intellectual property. And one of the things that's really important to us is keeping novel materials secret until they're ready to be patented. And so we need to operate on a need-to-know basis. At the same time, we want our scientists to have as much information as possible to allow them to do their jobs. And so this system is allowing us to do that in a kind of a fail-fast way, very performant.
Awesome. So let's say make it through the traffic light here, or the traffic check. What happens next?
Yeah. So we travel up to our Remix Lambda, and this is a kind of a monolithic node application that handles rendering our user interface and interacting with our data store. So the database we have for this product is a Aurora managed Postgres. That's where all the material data ultimately resides.
Okay, so that's the flow for your scientists, but I see another Lambda here. Why do we have two Lambdas in this workflow?
Yeah, so scientists are not going to be the only audience within our company who want to know more about our materials as they're being developed. So we also have an audience of primarily business analysts who might want programmatic access to this information.
We hope you enjoyed this look into some of the ways our customers are using compute with AWS Cloud Solutions. Find out more by watching the full episodes from the links in the description. And keep watching This Is My Architecture.